International astronauts and cosmonauts, all members of the Association of Space Explorers, gathered in September 2008 at the University of Washington in Seattle for two panel discussions, International Space Programs Review and Human Health for Long-Duration Exploration. This program is part of a series featuring Pavel Vinogradov, Russian cosmonaut, reviewing his country's space program.
Good afternoon. And welcome. I think we heard a very interesting presentation. I think it's going to be very easy for me to continue. Basically, my presentation is going to be devoted to a very particular, very special topic. The previous two increments that returned to the ground were not as comfortable in terms of how they landed as it had been in the past. So my presentation is going to be devoted to what exactly happened with Soyuz TMA-10 and TMA-11 during their landings. I will elaborate a little bit on the history of the landing of our vehicles, a little bit on off-nominal landings on the 18th of May 1969, when the vehicle Soyuz 5 returned to the ground. Boris Volynov crew, the vehicle entered into the ballistic trajectory. And that was, first of all, because the vehicle separation system didn't work flawlessly. On the 4th of May 2003, during the return of the Soyuz TMA-1 vehicle with Nikolai Budarin, Ken Barasok and Don Petit on board, approximately 1 minute 20 seconds after the beginning of the controlled descent, the automated systems of the vehicle transitioned the vehicle onto the ballistic trajectory. And that was because there was a deviation in one of the landing electronic boxes. My presentation is mostly going to be devoted to the two landings of the Soyuz TMA-10 and the Soyuz TMA-11. Soyuz TMA-10 is the crew of Oleg Kotov, Fedor Yurchikhin, and Sheikh Muzaffar, who is in this room today. On the 22nd of October 2010, the crew was returning to the ground,
and
transitioned onto the ballistic trajectory. That was because the vehicle separation system worked off nominally. We conducted quite a lot of investigation, a lot of research was done of that situation. 6 months after that, however, when Soyuz TMA-11 was returning with Yuri Malenchenko, Peggy Whitson, and our Korean cosmonaut or astronaut, I'm not sure if I should use cosmonaut or astronaut, the situation basically repeated itself. There was some slight difference between those two situations. However, basically, we saw that the process of the separation of the vehicle happened in approximately the same off-nominal fashion. However, when the Soyuz TMA-11 landed, the situation was much more complex and complicated. Let me remind you how exactly the landing is happening. The Soyuz vehicle separates from the station, it performs a number of maneuvers, it gets into a certain attitude. After that, we generate the deceleration burn, and after that the vehicle enters into the descent trajectory. At the altitude of approximately 100 kilometers, there is a command of the onboard computer that is sent, and that command separates the vehicle into the three compartments: the descent module itself, the habitation compartment, and also the instrumental compartment where the engine of the vehicle actually is. At the altitudes between 105 and 102 kilometers, there is the entry of the descent module into the atmosphere. In other words, the atmosphere, quote-unquote, captures the descent module, and after that, the controlled stage of the descent is beginning to happen. The most complicated dynamic stage is the stage when the vehicle is passing through the atmosphere. At the altitude of a little bit above 10 kilometers, there is the deployment of the parachute, and then nominally there is landing onto the surface with the soft landing engines deployed. This is the nominal process that is supposed to be used for all landings of our Russian vehicles. In order to understand what exactly happened in those particular off-nominal situations, I would like to elaborate a little bit more on the separation timeline for the separation of the vehicles into compartments. This vehicle consists of three compartments. It's the habitation compartment, the descent module, where the crew actually is, and also the instrumental compartment, where there is the engine and some other compartments and tools. The descent module and the habitation compartment are connected with special pyro bolts. The descent module is connected with a special truss and with the instrumental compartment. Over here, for each interface, we have pyro bolts and spring loaders that separate those compartments during the actual separation. The timeline itself happens relatively quickly. In 2.5 seconds, we have a bunch of operations that are shown here. First of all, we separate the adapter from the habitation compartment so that it wouldn't interfere with the proper separation of the habitation compartment. After that, we cut all the manifolds and all the electrical interfaces and connectors that we have over here from the instrumental compartment. We jettison the periscope for the cosmonaut. After that, we separate the pressurized adapter from the descent module. And after that, we send a command for the actual separation between the descent module and the habitation compartment. So basically, it's a pretty complicated timeline, it may seem. However, we never had any issues whatsoever with that timeline. All commands went through flawlessly always. If all those commands are not performed the way they're supposed to, the onboard computer understands it, and the onboard computer starts the timeline again, and it always results in the proper separation of the vehicle compartments. This timeline shows how exactly the descent module is separated from the instrument compartment. We do not show the habitation compartment here, it has already separated. And the spring pushes, the springs that are located over here on the truss, are loaded in such a way that the descent module moves within that particular corridor, within that particular cone. We can see over here that the descent module, when it separates from the other compartments, starts rotating relative to this axis. It is done on purpose, so that the descent module would never flow hatch forward. One of the most critical situations for us is when a descent module can enter atmosphere facing this part of the module. That's
Я дальше скажу,
a critical situation that we by all means want to avoid. Later in my presentation, I'm going to elaborate on this. In our off-nominal landings, we had situations when the descent module was traveling in the atmosphere hatch forward, but that was because the instrumental compartment didn't separate properly. Also, I'm going to elaborate a little bit more on the timeline, on the major operations of the TMA-11 timeline, because they are pretty similar to TMA-10. Basically, at 9:06:27, Moscow Daylight Savings Time, there was the separation of the transport vehicle from the station, and 10:33 to 10:55, the vehicle performed all the dynamic operations required. We prepared the vehicle for descent. Also, we got the vehicle into proper attitude. We checked the readiness of all the systems of the vehicle, their readiness for descent. At 10:52:23, we got a readiness status for the attitude control system. Basically, that means that all the systems of the vehicle are ready for descent. At 11:40:46, we fired the thrusters, and the thrusters fired for 115 meters that were required, and the vehicle transitioned into the descent trajectory. For that particular landing, we had a number of issues, quite a few actually, both for the crew and for the MCC. But the most important issue that we actually were faced with was the following. We did not have good radio comm, steady radio comm with the crew after the deceleration burn was performed. Basically, that particular situation was a concern.
Что происходило на траектории спуска,
as far as
мы знали только по косвенным признакам.
As far as what was happening during the descent, we could not know it directly from our tools and sensors. We got only indirect indications. Obviously, we received information from our counterparts, including information from the Mission Control Center in the United States. As a rule, landing of such vehicles, both our vehicles and American vehicles that are manned, always monitored by our air stations and by our observation stations. Even though we didn't have radio comm with the crew and couldn't talk to them, we understood during the actual descent that the descent was not nominal. We understood that the crew followed the ballistic trajectory. At 12:04:42, we had the separation of the compartments. At 12:30:01, we had the landing of the descent module at the ballistic, at the end of the ballistic trajectory on the ground. And now I would like us to see how the descent in the atmosphere is happening. I think that if you have the experience of landing on the Apollo, on the shuttle, or on the Soyuz, you may remember those wonderful and intense minutes when the vehicle is floating in a cloud of plasma. This is the separation of Soyuz TMA-8 from the station. This is how it looks like. This is basically the separation of the compartments. There is the descent module leading the way, and the other two modules are burning in the atmosphere. We can see that the instrumental compartment is burning, the habitation compartment is burning. The highest G-load that the crew is experiencing is happening for about 4.5 to 5 minutes. Over here, we can see three people in this module who eventually land happily on the ground. And now I would like to elaborate a little bit more on the situation that actually happened with two our vehicles. This particular chart shows in detail all the milestones of that particular landing, beginning with the separation of the compartments at the top left-hand corner. The vehicle relative to the horizon occupies this particular position, and then the command to separate the compartments is sent. That you remember, I showed you the difficult, that long sequence of commands. This is when that sequence of command is sent. During the nominal descent, those three compartments separate, and as I said, the descent module is following this particular trajectory. It's also rotating at the boundary when the atmosphere is about to capture the vehicle. There is the stabilization of the descent module, and then there is a control descent. In case of Yuri Malenchenko crew landing, we did not have the separation of the descent module and the instrumental compartment. And the atmosphere, when it started really capturing the vehicle, resulted in basically the stack taking this particular position and configuration. You see that the angles were changing a little bit, the stack was kind of swaying from a side to a side, but for a long time the entire vehicle, the entire stack was floating, was flowing hatch forward. This is the worst case scenario that we can think of in our books. I'm not going to elaborate on that much more. We can see that the vehicle control system understood the situation. Those red dots is the firing of the instrumental compartment thrusters. Those thrusters try to compensate such major deviations of the vehicle on almost all the three axes. The crew also observed the strange behavior of the vehicle.
The crew could not
interfere whatsoever into the computer control timeline, so all they had to do is to brace themselves and expect the best. This is approximately the same data, only the parameters here are somewhat different. The altitude is 140 kilometers. This is when the separation of the vehicles, of the compartments, was supposed to be happening. We can see that the instrumental and aggregate compartment did not separate. And the air dynamic flow rotated the vehicle. And this is the plot of the increase of the aerodynamic load. At this particular location, at this particular place, solar arrays were torn from the vehicle. Over here, the temperature of the airflow were raised up to 1300 degrees, and this is 80 kilometers. This is where we're entering the dense layers of the atmosphere. Nevertheless, the vehicle still continued to follow this particular route. At the altitude of about 69 to 68 kilometers, the airflow became so strong and the temperature was so high that there was the destruction of the instrumental and aggregate compartment, and it got torn away from the descent module. Those peaks of the angle sensors show how complex the dynamic behavior of the descent module was. It was basically tumbling in all three axes.
Но тем не менее, вот с этого момента,
nevertheless, beginning with this moment in time, up to
100 seconds,
the control system was still trying to control the vehicles in the control descent module, or rather in the control descent mode.
И когда углы,
and
которые
when
измеряют
the angles that are
подошли к своему пределу,
measured by the
автоматика сформировала
gyroscopes
признак
exceeded the maximum
спуска.
Possible measured values, the automated software went transitioned into the ballistic mode.
Вот с этого момента
so
видно,
when we got off scale max, we can see that from this particular moment the motion control system annihilated almost all the deviations, all the angular rates got into their nominal values for the ballistic descent, and after that the vehicle was following the ballistic descent timeline.
Вот этот график,
we can see this particular chart that shows you the dynamic operations, in other words, how exactly the descent module was separated from the instrument and aggregate compartment. We can see that there is a relatively steep increase of the angular rate. That angular rate exceeded the nominal value by almost 4 times. And then there was the oscillation that we can see.
Что нам дало возможность судить о том, что
basically it allows us to draw a conclusion that one out of 5 latches of the separation system interface did not deploy, did not open. Between the instrumental compartment and the descent module, there was a mechanical interface that did not open. Over here we can see
ситуация, когда
the situation,
мы видим, что часть
we can see that
замков
some latches deployed and worked nominally, and this one particular latch on plane 1 of the vehicle stayed closed in the closed position.
При этом
at the same time, for the Soyuz TMA-10, for the cord of crew, this particular angle of the opening was 10.5 degrees. And for Yuri Malenchenko and Peggy Whitson crew, that angle was less, that was 6 degrees. In other words, the latch worked even worse than in the previous flight. Now, let me show you how exactly it is happening over time, how that separation was happening. So over here you can see that the mast is removed from the descent module, and these are the attachment points for the aggregate and instrumental compartment and the descent module. And this is the latch that unfortunately did not open. We also conducted a lot of investigation and a lot of analysis of how the separation was happening. We basically tested several dozen of theories about what could have happened. I'm going to elaborate on that a little bit more, but now I would like to tell you a little bit about the situation that happened during the Soyuz TMA-11. Because the vehicle was traveling hatch forward for a long time in an off-nominal attitude, we achieved very high temperatures of the surface of the descent module. This is the temperature 310 degrees Celsius that our sensors indicated. That is the temperature on the internal side, on the internal surface of the hull of the descent module. In other words, that is the temperature inside the compartment where the crew was.
Второе, что мы увидели,
the second observation that we had is the following. The pitch thruster unit was almost entirely destroyed. The fact that it was almost destroyed showed that the temperature on the external surface of the descent module was critical, that was over 1860 degrees Celsius.
Также сгорела щелевая антенна, которая находилась на люке спускаемого аппарата.
The slit antenna on the hatch of the descent module was destroyed. The temperature for melting of that antenna is 1470 degrees Celsius.
Посадка Союза ТМА-10 она была более.
The descent of Soyuz TMA-10 was more quote-unquote comfortable for the crew because the temperature on the external side, on the internal side rather of the hull was only 140 degrees Celsius. And I'm almost done with my presentation. A couple of words about the area where we landed. We nominally usually land
точкой управляемого спуска. В этот раз мы не долетели почти 400
in the control descent area, and this time we moved ahead of that location by 430 kilometers. The crew landed in the ballistic landing area. After the deployment of the parachute, there was a significantly strong wind. That wind carried the descent module for some more time, and the descent module traveled for 51 more kilometers. Even in that particular situation, the rescue services worked pretty good, and 22 minutes after the descent module landed, the first helicopter was already picked up the beacon of the descent module, and sometime after that, two helicopters landed in the area where the descent module was on the ground. Over here you can see the crew, Oleg Kotov, Fyodor Yuchihin, Sheikh Muzaffar,
Yuri Malenchenko. Буквально через несколько минут после того, как поисково-спасательная служба вертолёта
is the crew commander, and this picture was taken almost in a few minutes after the rescue service helicopters landed. A few words about the damage of the crew. This is the pitch thruster block. This is the hatch where the slit antenna used to be. You see the antenna is almost entirely destroyed, and over here we can see some temperature damage of other components of the descent module. I am not going to elaborate a lot about the theories why it has happened. Our analysis and investigation allowed us to draw two major conclusions. The first conclusion, even in those difficult and complicated landing conditions, the design of the vehicle was able to withstand those loads and the crew and challenges. The vehicle rather performed its tasks. The crew returned to the ground safely. And the second conclusion is the crew during the entire flight obviously showed their psychological compatibility, showed the highest level of professionalism, and allowed them to avoid the worst possible consequences.
Спасибо.
Thank you.